So hello again, we meet again very soon on very short notice. This is Podcast with Neil and I'm your favorite host, Neil as the name suggests. Not London Derby, exquisite match. Not just exquisite, it has a thing to about, it is a thing about it after a long time. Arteta is under pressure, Mourinho wants to make the top and he has a great chance of going on top judging by the recent forms. And so just to talk about that North London Derby, which will be in focus as well as FPL, what we do every day, we have two very special guests. Just introducing them on screen right now. I have Umang Astana,
hi,
an Arsenal fan, and Chirantan is joining. He's not a Spurs fan. We managed to get a Spurs fan last week on loan, but due to lack of Spurs fan in India. So if anyone is watching who's a Spurs fan, please raise your hand up. We'll be wanting you for the next podcast in the Spurs, when Spurs have a good match. But till now, Chirantan has to suffice. So, North London Derby. I'll go to Umang first. What even after Arteta took charge of reins last season, we saw him as a breath of fresh air, coming and defeating Pep and playing some exquisite football. Do you think that he has died down mainly because of his naivety in tactics, what we see Pep, or the players have let him down, or consequence of both?
So, hi guys. I think it's a consequence of both because I think he wasn't even bad in the summer, because we got only Thomas Partey and that defender Gabriel. Gabriel is good, but Partey, I think since he joined, has been injured for a while. Today he'll play. I saw him in the practice and all. So I think he hasn't been bad in the summer, and we have a lot of what you call deadwood in the squad. So these are the same players which let Arsene Wenger down, Unai Emery down, and he has to deal with them now. So I think once he gets all his 11, then I think we'll compete for the trophies and all. But right now I don't think that we'll compete for anything apart from Chirantan, cups. Maybe
Chirantan, coming to you, you've been a Jose fan, a Jose fanboy, as you stated last week in our podcast then. So, how do you think is Jose Mourinho going to advance in this? Because we know Arsenal have been pegged deep. I'll go into the tactics a bit later with the shape and all. Do you think this is route one Jose all over again, or will he turn up attacking this time? Because Arsenal are there for the taking.
I think he'll have to attack somewhat, because two reasons. A, he's at home, and B, he's got fans. So, he cannot play the boring kind of football that he played last week, right? Like a 0.00 XG in the second half, that sort of a thing, Jose will get booed the hell out of it, right? So he will have to play attacking, and the points are there for the taking, to be honest. Having said that, Jose is very clear he doesn't want to lose. That's his first thing. He at least wants one point and ensures that there is no change in gap with the opposition, right? So he will definitely ensure his base is first, and the fact that there is no Toby, so he will get that keep that cover also handy. I think last week it was he was Kane versus Kante. This week, probably it will be Kane versus Partey. I don't know, but I'm not very sure how healthy Partey is right now, because he's coming back after a long layoff. But Kane playing a little deeper, and Højbjerg would be more active today. So that is where the key battle is going to be, because I don't think they'll get a chance to run behind, because Arsenal will also be playing low block, right? They will not be too high line as such. But so Son might not be so key, but Kane will be the key. So how you handle Kane is where the game is going to lie.
Quite an interesting aspect to what Harry Kane has been playing. I'll go to Umang for a bit. Umang,
yeah.
Arsenal's defensive structure has been quite of a reshuffle at times, like playing Gabriel, partnering up with Socrates, Mustafi once in a while. We haven't seen that much of William Saliba, because he has been heavily linked to be the defensive partner in the long run. Uh-huh. When David Luiz coming in, giving some David Luiz-esque performances, some Maldini-esque performances. But whom do you think, what pair do you think Arteta will go to? Considering Tierney will play the left centre back, what other players do you think Arteta will go with, considering that he has to stop Harry Kane, Heung-min Son, and or Gareth Bale or Bergwijn?
I think he'll play three at the back with David Luiz if he's fit. And Gabriel is for sure. And I don't think he should play Kieran Tierney as a left centre back, because I think he should play as a wing back, because he's a very good crosser of the ball. so we need some chances because we are not creating any, and we don't have Mesut Ozil, which we'll come back on. But yeah, so I think the three should be holding David Luiz and Gabriel, and then moving forward, KT and all that.
But does Arteta trust holding at all? He just gives me the vibe that he doesn't trust holding at all.
Yeah, I think so. He doesn't, but you can't do anything. He has what he has. He can't play Pablo Mari because he just joined in after a long injury. Mustafi, he doesn't trust anymore. We also don't trust him.
Pablo Mari got hurt in the first match after a restart, right? That is the injury he's carrying till
now. Yeah. I think it was the City match at the Etihad. Yeah.
6 months. Wow. That's a really long
injury. So he came just now. I don't think he'll start. And yeah, these three are left only because I don't think Mustafi will also start. And coming on to William Saliba, I think William Saliba has had family issues also. Like his mom died and he's in a foreign country. So I think that is holding him back. And might be he'll go to, I think, Saint Etienne, because I heard the rumor that they are, I think they want him back for 6 years. Yeah, they want him back. Yeah, maybe, I think next season, I think we'll see of him. Saliba and Gabriel partnership.
Very importantly, as the topic about Mustafi that went on, I don't know if any player trusts Mustafi at this point of time, because last season I remember him marking a referee, playing Aguero onside, like too many mistakes from just one. Chirantan, being a Chelsea fan and being the pride of London as it is right now, being between you and Tottenham, just want to ask you this very cheekily, that do you think Arsenal at this point of time are like Derby County of old? Like every team is going against Arsenal at this point of time. Arsenal are not managing to score. Aubameyang hasn't scored since, they have not had a shot since
Manchester United,
if I'm not wrong.
Arsenal
there for the taking at this moment of time? Would that enrage you, or would that may bring a smile to your face?
Honestly, they are there for the taking, but North London Derby is a very different game, right? I'll tell you a very unique experience. So 2001 season ka match tha. It was at White Hart Lane, the old White Hart Lane. The match was nil-nil till 37th minute, okay? And the match finished at 5-4 in favor of Arsenal. They scored 9 goals in some 45 minutes, okay? So that's how mad things can get. I don't expect 9 goals today, of course. It'll probably be a 2-1 or a 1-1.
Yeah.
Could be nil-nil also, actually. But I think for sure, we'll see a different Arsenal show up today. Because if they don't show up today, then it's really bad news. Then probably heads will roll. Because this is a matter of pride, right? It's more than just a game. It's like India-Pakistan back in the day, right? So, and it's very similar roots also, right? Because India-Pakistan ka bhi zameen ka ladai tha na. So here also it's the same thing. Like Arsenal were Woolwich Wanderers, who were a South London club who moved to North London and barged into Tottenham's territory, right? So it's a very, very similar battle to India-Pakistan. So it's a matter of pride. No matter how badly they might be playing, they would be showing up in a different light. You will have a couple of yellow cards and a couple of headbutts and stuff like that. Too bad Pepe is not there, else you'd get a red card today also. But but yeah, I think it's going to be a different game today, man. And I really hope Arsenal do well and get a point at least.
I know why you hope Arsenal do well.
we all are looking for that result. Even I'm hoping for an Arsenal win, because that would help United climb up to the top of the tree of the table. Going back to Umang on this, like, we have talked about Arsenal, we have talked about Tottenham, Jose Mourinho's Tottenham especially. But do you think that this is a match where which team chokes first? Like, we have seen Tottenham sit back, we have seen Arsenal sit back and not being very good at that. They are more expansive when they're on the roll of the play, Willian and all, getting on those combinations in those triangles. Do you think this will be a match of which team will choke? Because Tottenham has had that ability to choke, because we remember that they just had a draw with 3-3 draw with the last in Europa League, playing kind of fail and stuff. But do you think they somehow, wherever they go, Tottenham, like, they are always known as serial perennial bottlers? Is that for a reason,
They are,
or
they
is
are.
that just Jose Mourinho is walking away with the title this season? What have you say on this?
Mourinho. Firstly, they are Spurs, so they won't be winning anything. I think Chelsea has a chance. Spurs won't win anything. Secondly, they are doing well because I think it's a new manager bounce. Every team gets that. I think we were the imposters in doing that. We didn't have that. Choking first. I don't think so that Jose should. I mean, sit back in this game because we have a weak defense. Gabriel alone won't defend anything. We have a weak defense, and they have Kane, Son. I think Bergwijn is there. Gareth Bale also. Lucas Moura. So I think he should attack us, and at some point of time we will choke. I don't want us to, but yeah, we will choke. So let's see what happens.
Maybe is having some technical difficulties. We know Chelsea.
Yeah, I think power issue. I think.
just waiting for him to join.
Yeah.
He says he's there. Power cut. Yeah, had a power cut.
Yeah.
Okay, moving back. I'll continue with you.
Yeah.
Like I'll just bring up a statistic for you. Not just a statistic. We have seen how different Harry Kane has been playing from when he played with Mauricio Pochettino, where he had a number 10 per se, and in Dele Alli, where he was playing very well. Giovanni Lo Celso was brought in to replace Christian Eriksen in that front. Now Harry Kane has been moved into that deep lying forward role where he creates more than his goals. He scores, but he is creating role. If I just bring up the statistic, see how Harry Kane's positioning. This was 2018-19. Here, the green mark person is Harry Kane. See how his positioning has changed. Like he was the number one striker. This is the half season when Jose Mourinho came in. This is the season right now. This is 2021 right now. See, in a matter of like 6 months, just 6 months, Harry Kane's positioning has changed so much. Is this tactical brilliance by Tottenham's Jose Mourinho, or is this like a lack of a proper number 10? Because we know how much Jose loves number 10s with the likes of, he bought Mkhitaryan for United. If I say Wesley Sneijder's, Joe Cole's of old. Like he loves the number 10. He tried.
Ozil at Real Madrid also.
Absolutely. Ozil was a phenomenon at Real Madrid, even though he played a right wide role at times when Di Maria was playing inside. But at this point of time, do you think this team lacks a proper number 10 to go to that just a bit edge and make them surefire contenders for the title?
You can say that they lack, but I don't think they do. Because Harry Kane, when he drops back, he has wingers which are fast, like Son, Bergwijn, Bale and Lucas Moura. And you know how good he is at passing. So he can create chances. He has, I think, 8 assists, if I'm not wrong, 8 assists he has. So I think it's tactical brilliance by Jose to use him as a false nine and to involve him in more of the game. Yeah.
Chirantan, moving to you, welcoming you back after your initial power cut stint. So I was talking with Umang about how Harry Kane has actually shifted his position in the last year. Like this was under Mauricio Pochettino. This was the half season when Jose Mourinho came in, and this is like the season that we are in right now. See, clear transition there, where Harry Kane, you see that not much of a difference between 1920 and 2021. But do you think is this the season where Tottenham really lack a number 10? We talked about how Jose loves a number 10 in his days. Mesut Ozil, Wesley Sneijder, even Mkhitaryan at United, he tried him there. But is this Tottenham side lacking a proper number 10 after the departure of Christian Eriksen and the lackluster performances of Dele Alli? And do you think that just one signing, one number 10 and a defender, that would propel them towards undeniable glory?
Honestly, right now what they're doing is, what Jose is doing, a very smart thing. He's trying to build Ndombele into that role, okay? But he's meanwhile filling in with Harry Kane, because Harry Kane obviously has a lot of quality. So I do feel that sooner rather than later, as Ndombele grows into the role, which he's doing very well in Europa right now, and
he was playing really well against Chelsea last week also. So maybe by end of January, another 2 months time, you will see Ndombele in a very established space and Harry Kane start going up again and starting to focus more on goals. Because one thing he also realizes, Jose, is the fact that teams have figured out that right now they have only two outlets in terms of threat, Son and Kane. So blocking them out can actually nullify Tottenham in a very bad way. So therefore, once Ndombele matures slightly more, he of course had a massive issue with Ndombele last season, right? So they didn't start off on a good note. And Dele Alli started off really well. Things have gone completely opposite for those two of them. So once Ndombele stabilizes a little more, probably you'll see more of Ndombele in that role and Kane going up again. But meanwhile, so far, so good, right? Because Kane, two things, like we discussed last week also, he's delivering more and because he's playing lower, there are less harsh tackles and chances of injury is also less, which is his normal annual phenomenon. Like he gets injured every year, which is a massive
but
problem.
But at the end of the day, Ndombele isn't your number 10. He's not going to play those line-breaking passes. Like, this is Arsenal.
He's a centre mid, right? He's a centre mid, right? He's not a cam.
He's a box to box.
Yeah, number 8.
But if you saw the game against City, right? The ball that he played to Son, and even the other day against Chelsea, he was trying to put balls forward. So there is a clear tendency for them to do that. And I saw that match for Ludogorets. I don't know why I watched that match though, but I did. So in that match, actually, Ndombele was taking a lot of money. Yeah, so I was just hoping that Spurs play all their players so that they are fatigued for Sunday. That was my logic. So, anyways, so yeah, Ndombele has a lot of creative potential because I watched some of his old packages. Like, of course, YouTube videos don't do justice, but he does have a vision for a ball. And what Kane is doing right now, if he's coached well, he can do it at an 80% level of that. And of course, not at Kane's level because Kane is delivering at a very radical output level. Right? So,
but if you say, Umang, I'm coming to you on this, but
yeah,
whatever it might be, like lack of a number 10 players not gelling in or problems like that. But if Arsenal, that's most probable, that there's a most good chance that Arsenal go down in this North London derby. Like, is it time to say that Arteta out in that brigade? Because Ole out is there every week. I'm dealing with my own fan base. And I am like, why, man? Dealing with Pogba is one thing and dealing with my own fast bits is another. Like, for instance, just one fun fact to share. Yesterday, Pogba in the first half looked like someone who has the proximity or a decision-making of a cockroach. Like, he's one of those guys who would go into the iPhone store or whatever that is called. I'm a poor guy with an Android phone, so I don't know what it is called. Go to an iStore and buy an iPhone 12 and leave his fridge empty. It's just like that. In the second half, just when Bruno Fernandes came in and he just changed, took the game by the scruff of the neck and changed everything. All of the players looked motivated. And just by moving that defensive shape a yard up, United had all the possession. Similarly, I see Arsenal staying in too deep. And that might just falter into Jose's hands because that's what they did to United. Yeah. They had to sit deep and they overlapped with their fullbacks, made a lot of 3v3s, the 3v2 situations out wide and crosses into the box. That's what happened. Do you think this, if this happens, there's a good probability, is it time to say Arteta out? Because a long time, Arsenal are 14th or something like that, Chirantan?
Yeah, yep. 15th.
Now 15. Palace has gone 15. Up now. Yeah. Palace scored 5 goals. Yeah.
5-1 they won.
What do you think, Umang?
No, I don't think it's time to say Arteta out because he has been in charge of Arsenal. It's not even a full year. I think he has been in charge of Arsenal. And if you remove the COVID time also, he had COVID himself also. So he recovered that. But I don't think it's time to say Arteta out. I'll give him one more season this January window and that summer window. If he manages to get his own team, then I think we'll see a proper Arsenal team. And after that, if he fails to, deliver, then it's sorted out.
Talking about this getting your own team, I don't understand this philosophy that fans, Arsenal fans say to me, that Arsenal, Arteta build his own team up. But at the same point of time, you guys fired your own mascot to get Partey. Like, you guys are running on burnt fumes at the moment of time. So how do you expect to? I'll actually ask Chinantan on this because he'll take a dig on Arsenal and
I'm already hated a lot by Arsenal fans, dude.
Actually, I wanted to. I mean, correct you on this. Arsenal fired that mascot. It was, I think, when they announced that 55 redundancies which they were making. He was one of them only, but I don't know how it got lead in the media, and just after that we signed Thomas Partey. So you know, it became a whole story that we fired our mascot at Thomas Partey.
On that same note, Chirantan, going to you on this, like, I heard Gary Neville during the podcast that was held in the pandemic. Like, if the club has money to spend on a proper transfer, then why the club do not have money to pay their own staff, those are running the clubs behind the scenes? This is such a debacle. Someone should address this, right?
Yeah. So it's unfortunate, but I did some research. So like Umang is saying, right? So the problem is the timing. They had already planned for the redundancies with or without COVID. But as it so happened, COVID came in and their financial situation looked much worse. And laying off people obviously was a PR disaster. So if I were in charge of Arsenal board, I would have probably continued with those people for like 6 more months, borne the cost of their salary and laid them off at a time which is a little more suitable. Because in the middle of pandemic, if you lay people off, it's massive PR disaster. And that's where Arsenal went wrong, right? 6 महीना सैलरी देना उनके लिए प्रॉब्ली इट वुड हैव बीन अनदर 5 मिलियन पाउंड्स एट मैक्स इवन इफ दे आर रियली कॉस्टली पीपल राइट सो 4-5 मिलियन पाउंड्स के लिए इतना पीआर डिजास्टर डजंट मेक सेंस आई थिंक दैट्स वेयर द प्रॉब्लम इज लाइक
दैट सर्कुलेटेड
इन इफ आई वर इन देयर शूज आई वुड हैव प्रॉब्ली फायर्ड देम इन डिसेंबर एंड नॉट इन अप्रैल मे बिकॉज थिंग्स वुड मच बेटर एट लीस्ट थिंग्स वुड बी क्लोजर टू नॉर्मल
व्होएवर इज वाचिंग इफ चिरंतन यू आर वर्किंग अंडर चिरंतन एट एनी पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम डू नॉट ही इज वन मीन बॉस Okay, the banter aside, coming to Umang on this, like, we talked about PR disaster, but the disaster is happening on the field. Like, I'll bring up a slide where Arsenal, this one, sorry, why is it not coming? Okay, it's here. If you see Arsenal's average positioning versus Leicester, even when they have the ball, you expect Jose Mourinho to be in this kind of a shape, man for man, covering the zones, covering the channels, the triangles, so that no triangles kind of form, because they have very industrious midfielders. So this is, it's either Boyaco Saka, Willian or Nicolas Pepe, whoever it is, doesn't this seem to you that Arsenal lack a supreme playmaker? Doesn't this seem to you, because one line breaking pass, two of your forwards are in this man-to-man formation as far as tactics go. And I'm no Marcelo Bielsa, but even a noob can understand that. But I know the Mesut Ozil, what happened with Mesut Ozil and his what going on inside. I'll not go into that much because we'll cover up the length of the video. But don't you think Arsenal are in more need of a natural playmaker than of a defensive midfielder at this point of time?
Actually, we needed both. But Arteta was after Hasem Awar, if you know the rumors. He was linked with us and very heavily. Arteta wanted him. And he wanted Partey also, but I don't know how we didn't have, funds to get both. So we got Partey. I think we should play Ozil, but I don't know what is the reason why he doesn't start Sim. Because I think the foundation is very good for Ozil now, as we have that DM, if we wanted since last, 4 or 5 years. Not 4 or 5 years, I think it's 15 years since we wanted Patrick Vieira since he left. So yeah, we have that DM. Now Ozil can play his game, but for footballing reasons, as he said.
Yeah, that's true. Like, it's definitely not footballing reasons. It has to be something non-footballing. And
It is something non-footballing. Like, I had read somewhere it gone viral that he had beef with China.
China.
Yes, let's not discuss that. Otherwise, your podcast will also get red flag.
Increase one hour, yeah.
See over here, what I was saying, the Mesut Ozil debacle, it's the same team. It's against Leicester itself on another year. See, the line-breaking passes. Just if I roll back to this, you put an Ozil over here. and he gets this, and he gets to play these passes. We have seen him doing this for umpteen amounts of time for Real Madrid, for Germany, for Arsenal when Alexis was there, because Arsenal have runners at this point of time, and Ozil doesn't have to worry about going backtracking on defense. Not everybody is a Bruno Fernandes, but at this point of time, Ozil is what Arsenal have got. Chirantan, what do you think? Should footballing matters be the only contingent in a football club rather than what is happening at Arsenal at this point of time?
I don't know what is should, but it definitely is not the case, because it's such a big game of money, right? And China is such a big market as a whole. The owners cannot, for their own business interest, the owners cannot risk China market going against them, right? And that's where the safety first policy came in. And also there are a couple of, they are also being, penny pinching. Because in Ozil's contract, there are certain bonuses which is linked to the number of starts he makes. So they are probably saving a part of his wages also by not playing him at all. But it is stupid to think that they're doing it at the cost of the club, because the most money you make is a winning.
Right.
Yeah, I think it's network issue.
Yeah, his power has not come back on. Okay, Umang, I'm going on to you in a bit. I'm just muting you, Chirantan, until you come back. So, Umang, tell me on this. Like, we have discussed Arsenal. We have discussed Tottenham. What do you think? Okay, Chirantan is back. What do you think, Umang, would be an ideal solution to this Arteta's reign at this point of time? Not considering transfers, but from what tactical point of view I understand is that playing Bukayo Saka as a wing back is, I think, completely wasting his natural playmaking abilities, because I have seen him in the England setup under the under-21s, under-23s and the senior team recently, that he is a brilliant playmaker and you could mold him into that role as well.
He can play as a playmaker, but I don't think he'll play. I think he trusts Willian. I don't know why he trusts Willian. And
he didn't listen to Chelsea fans. That's the problem. Had he listened to Chelsea fans, he would not trust Willian.
Yeah, seriously, man. I think he should play Willian as a 10 for now, because we don't have a number 10. For now, he should play Willian as a 10. And I know he'll not perform in that also. He's so shit. Man, I'm sorry. I'm not a huge admirer of him. I just hate that guy. After Fulham, I think he hasn't played a good game.
He got an assist though last game, right? Against Wolves?
Yeah, I think it was a good header rather than a good assist. Gabriel header was good. So, yeah.
So just FPL metrics, and coming on to the FPL segment in the last
one thing. One last point, Neil.
I'll just
give you some hope, Umang. Willian has been always good against Spurs. Like, he hates Spurs.
Yeah, yeah. Hope.
So the whole medical करने के बाद Chelsea join करना.
So,
right? He hates Spurs. So he generally plays really well against Spurs. And one of my favorite memories of Willian is actually from that Battle of Stamford Bridge when, you know, like Willian got fouled really bad, and he was just
Danny Rose,
and he was just thumping the golden crest in his jersey, like, yeah, we are champions, we'll never be that. So I think he's going to do well today. Like, let him play today, he'll probably get that big goal for you.
Hopefully.
Yeah, talking about Willian playing well or not well, because I was very stunned when he had a hat-trick of assists on the opening game day, because I had put him in and then got him out of the starting squad. Pain for me. But start sticking with Chirantan, Ziyech is out for 4 weeks. Martial, I don't know if any managers have them on their teams. I don't think even Ole would like to have him on his team at this point of time, the way he's performing. Ziyech is a very big miss. At that price range, he was the assist machine of so-called Premier League podcast that I've heard on the FPL channel. But
yeah,
if you say so, what would be your number two? What would your two replacements for in that price range replacing Ziyech?
I would actually replace Ziyech with Danny Ings. It's a different position, but the budget is the same. And Ings is back, and he's got really good players. No, he's back. He's back this week. So that's the rumor. He's training with the team. So even if he's not back this week, next game week onward, he should be back. He's got good fixtures. And pretty sure. I mean, if you can safely say that all the creativity in Southampton actually goes through him in terms of all the goal threats. Like Ward Prowse is the creative source, and this guy is the goal threat. So that is one, which is a non-position thing. If you talk about positionally, I think I would say that think of if you have budget, go for Sterling more than KDB, because Sterling generally scores against lower ranked teams, and he's playing lower ranked teams in the coming game weeks also. Like, and lastly,
Manchester United, come on.
Subsequent weeks I'm talking about, because United week, so I'm sure that there's going to be a low block and no goals happening, to be very, very honest.
And one
United will have like 10 players behind the ball, like quote unquote United way. Okay, counter attack pe khelne wale. So like not United wala match, but subsequently. Otherwise, there's this other really interesting player, which is Wilfried Zaha. He got one assist and two goals today.
Did you have him on a team? It looks like you had him on your team. Not
I had him, but I took him out because of COVID, and this time he's on my bench.
Okay, that's fair.
Yeah, 18 plus 3, I think. He got I think 21 points today or something. Like, or 18 points, yeah. 5 plus 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 2.
Umang, coming to you, we are yet to see the Liverpool match. Do you think it is still a good time to bring rope in Diego Jota, or do you think Mohamed Salah should be, he's the most captain player, if I must say. Retain that spot, or should Diego Jota be coming in, because he's at a very useful price range?
I don't know what his price is, but I actually don't play FPL, so I think you're asking the wrong guy.
Is this just me, or like a Spurs fan are not interested in FPL at this point of time? Loan or
Arsenal fan.
Arsenal fan. Okay, disclaimer. Arsenal fans and Spurs fans are not interested in FPL. Spurs fans are interested in finishing over Arsenal. Arsenal are interested in Gunnersaurus. And at this point of time, I don't know where
he's
Arsenal
back,
is
though,
But we have a very interesting North London derby fixture. So, just taking the final score line, if I must say, Chirantan, starting with you. One and two words, how the match will play out, final score line.
I think it's going to be a draw. Probably a 1-1 draw or a 2-1.
You cheeky man.
No, or it will be a 2-1 in the injury time. You know, like, that's what it looks like. By the way, the squads are out. If you can show the squads.
Just a second. I'm pulling it up. Umang, what do you think will be the score line today?
If I'm biased, then 4-0 Arsenal, Aubameyang hat-trick and Willian.
Even I can't do that on FIFA. I'm a very good FIFA player. Even I can't do that on FIFA. Come on.
So, biasness attack. I think Chirantan bhai ne jo kaha, wahi mujhe lag raha hai. Ya to jo hai draw hoga ya fir Arsenal injury time winner Gabriel Herrera 2-1. Can't see Spurs win, man.
I have the lineup with me. This is Spurs. Starts with Hugo Lloris, Serge Aurier, Reguilon, two fullbacks. Alderweireld is back. Eric Dier starts again at central defense. Sissoko Hojbjerg partnering. And we see a number 10 starting instead of Ndombele. Jungmin Song, Bergwijn on the wings. That is interchange. And Harry Kane leading the line or playing a defensive striker. And the same 3-4-3 formation for Arsenal. Brad Leno on goal, Kieran Tierney, Gabriel, Rob Holding. Trusted or not trusted, we still don't know. Bukayo Saka, Granit Xhaka. It's like Shaka Laka Boom, something like that. Xhaka, Laka, and Thomas Partey, Hector Bellerin. Bellerin has been an interesting pick, if I must say. He's been doing very well, but he's been very unlucky. And Umang's favorite player, Willian, on the right side.
Laka, Maestro.
If I go on the subs bench, here is where it is a gulfing class of difference. You see the Spurs bench, right? You have Gareth Bale, you have Lucas Moura coming on to change the game. Even Carlos Vinicius
pick up a cameo.
The Arsenal, just I don't see anyone but Dani Ceballos.
Dani Ceballos. Mustafi the goat, man.
Mustafi is more than a goat. If anyone who marks referees is a goat for me. Like, how can someone do that? I don't even know.
We also don't know. Why we bought him, we don't know.
I'm going to change my prediction. I think Perth will score two goals first. Arsenal will score one back for sure. 2-1 or 2-2 over. Because if because Lo Celso means the fact that he's Jose is playing a much more attacking story. Yes. Yeah, he's going much more attacking. So Aubameyang goal is also possible because
or maybe
they would
or maybe just to take away party from the game. Just mind game, just to take away party from the game.
I don't know. I mean, Lo Celso party ke sath one on one to nahi jaane wala hai. Lo Celso is more about like encouraging
just
Kane to Kane to go
those spaces. Like an Ndombele will not make those channel runs. Lo Celso
maybe.
But Ndombele is a better dribbler, so I think he would have probably taken man on better. Let's see how it goes. Should be a good game, that's all.
He's just starting in 10. So I think the final prediction, like Chirantan has gone with a 2-2, Umang has gone 4-0 sarcastically. He's also hoping for an Arsenal win. I'm also hoping for an Arsenal win as an United fan.
Very honestly,
I think this would be like a 3-1 win or a 3-0 win for Spurs, because very realistically, there's a gulfing class in difference with Tottenham and the rest of the sides at this point of time. So that's pretty much about it. Thanking Chirantan again and our debutant Umang Astana. We had a great session. And hope you'll be joining in for some later sessions as well, because we'll be diving deep into Arsenal. Just don't tune into Arsenal Fan TV. They are more hopeless than COVID at this point of time.
No, man. Ty is amazing. Like, you should watch Ty's video. He's the most optimistic man in the world.
You saw the heated exchange. He always just busts
around. Yeah. And you know, recently what they've done is they started, there's this handle called Mental Health Project. They've been the top commenter in AFTV videos now. Because they're like, I want positivity in my life. I'm struggling with depression. Can Ty please grant me some positivity?
Oh, shit. That was brutal. I can understand the despair Numang says. So that's just pretty much wrapping it up. We planned half an hour. It's been more than half an hour. It's been a fun session. Thank you, Chirantan. Thank you, Umang. Thank you guys for joining in. See you soon next time. So back to just Neil, your favorite host. So I've been doing a few podcasts very recently. The Man United match, you can check out the links. I don't have the links right now. You can check out them in the page there in the spotlight. I have also uploaded them on YouTube. If you just want to have a look. Support me. These are difficult times. COVID has been difficult for everyone. Slowly life is getting back to its happiness. But as I always say on the ending note of a show, that football is what keeps us united. And as a football fan, nothing more gives me immense joy than to see stadiums welcome back fans. And let's hope that we can have a full stadium soon. Let's hope the Old Trafford, the Stamford Bridges, the Etihad is always empty. The classic teams, the Liverpools, the Kop ends should be filled, and the Arsenal stand should be riling on like classic London power and pride. So thanking you for tuning in. It's been a joyride, and we're hoping for some new content soon. So till then, see you. Enjoy the North London Derby. It's on around in 40 minutes or so, 50 minutes or so. So let me see if it's a very good match. I'll do a tactical analysis at the end of the game. Depends on Jose Mourinho not parking the bus. So for the last time, this is Podcast with Neil. Thank you for tuning in. We'll see you very soon. Bye-bye. Take care.